Good evening and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. This is the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm your host, Aaron Dykes. Today is Monday, November 5th, 2012, just before the elections.
Tonight, Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Schaefer drops a bombshell on Benghazi Gate just one night before the 2012 presidential election. Plus, Hurricane Sandy is turning into Katrina 2.0. And Aaron Dykes previews the InfoWars special election coverage. That's coming up next, the InfoWars Nightly News.
After the flood comes the freeze. There is new news about the northeastern storm expected to hit New Jersey and New York in the wake of Sandy, as the aftermath has already been very chaotic, a very inappropriate response from FEMA, as at least 40,000 people are without shelter, without homes at the moment, particularly tens of thousands of public housing people who may be freezing in weather that may dip as low as the 20s. It may also bring more flooding, more freezing, and more destruction, perhaps even a bigger FEMA response. This is in Zero Hedge. It's also been reported in the New York Times, in Reuters, in CBS, and other mainstream blogs about the potential effect of the new storm expected to hit Wednesday after the elections in the areas most hard hit by Hurricane Sandy. Something to keep an eye on as we look to the fact that Sandy is now unfolding into a Katrina 2.0. Melissa Melton has that story, rounding up all the news in the wake of that terrible storm that hit the Atlantic Eastern Coast. You've got the New York Times and the fact that they celebrated immediately after the hurricane hit, how great FEMA was, how they were coming to the rescue. And yet we find in Breitbart, other outlets, how FEMA failed to even plan ahead for the basics of food and water. They ran out of water. That was on Drudge Report and other sites yesterday. It's not expected to arrive until today. They weren't able to distribute bottled water. They also didn't even do purchasing for food for the displaced residents in New York and New Jersey until Friday, when the bid closed on November 2nd, despite the fact they had 4, 5, maybe even 6 days where they knew the direction of the storm. It was completely accurate where they predicted it was going to hit. It actually hit, but they didn't plan ahead. Why? Because FEMA is the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Why didn't they plan ahead when it's their job, their critical mission, their mandate to protect the people most affected by this flooding? You've got gas shortages, fuel shortages, they're unable to heat things, and you've got people diving in dumpsters trying to find food when FEMA, of all their roles, is supposed to be there to at least meet those basic needs. They didn't do it. Didn't they learn their lesson from Katrina, where we saw thousands and thousands of people without homes, thrown into that terrible Superdome, which became a crime and cesspit? You had police on the bridges shooting people for trying to walk off the bridge and escape. You had the gun confiscations and everything else. Is that where the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy is heading? Well, we'll find out. But Melissa Melton also points out how FEMA's actual funding through congressional investigations and the Cox Newspaper Group study, they found that back in 1992 numbers, only about $243 million of FEMA's budget went to actual disaster relief, while almost $3 billion went to black ops. We've covered this extensively here at InfoWars.com, how FEMA's real mission and Homeland Security's real mission is to build up the continuity of government systems, how to keep an illegitimate form of government going if they decide that the constitutional form of government can't survive because of any kind of disaster, natural disaster, man-made terrorism, fallout from civil unrest, if there's a big economic collapse, you name it. That's what that federal family is really here for. They're not here to take care of you in a disaster, so you'd better make plans to take care of yourself. That's why, of course, people have argued to return that duty, which was traditionally held by local communities and in some instances states, back to the local scene and to private agencies who've been again and again and again hampered by FEMA's response. They keep volunteers away from the scene of disaster. They've even kept out the Red Cross, you name it. You've got people like Rudy Giuliani, Giuliani saying FEMA is as bad here in Sandy as they were in Katrina, although it's very limited comments, clearly just meant for this election cycle. I'm sure he would have done the same were he in power. That brings us to the election. It's still unclear what's going to happen with the vote in New Jersey and New York, but they're not swing states, so they probably won't affect the actual presidential decisions. But you heard Alex on with Bev Harris of blackboxvoting.org, one of the experts on election fraud, talking about how under the Help America Vote Act, they are required by law to have a disaster relief plan should they get hit by a storm, as happened, should they lose electricity, as has happened. And it's not clear that those things are happening, that those measures have been put into place, even though you see the military there with backup units to take the vote. Well, we're going to see what happens when all is said and done, because there may well be cases of fraud in close House, Senate races, other local races, something to keep an eye on. But the overall national election coverage is going to be bigger and better than ever this year in this very tight race. Infowars.com is doing live election coverage. Of course, Alex will have his regular show during the day's broadcast. We will still do the Infowars nightly news, but we're going to have a special free live stream broadcast from 5 p.m. Central to midnight Central, and we're going to have all kinds of guests outside of the regular left-right paradigm. When you turn on CNN, when you turn on Fox, and they call these races with 1% in, with just a few percentage ins, and they've got the typical pundits on either side of the fence, but never anywhere else in the spectrum, calling it like it supposedly is. Well, this is the real analysis you've been waiting for. It's people like Gerald Celente, people like Max Kaiser, Wayne Mattson, Paul Craig Roberts, Lou Rockwell, who says in some cases don't even vote for president, Nomi Prinz, who worked inside Wall Street and was a whistleblower, and of course Webster Tarpley, who always brings a very unique perspective to the debate. You don't want to miss that. Alex will of course be there. We're also going to have our mini InfoWars nightly news reporters out on the scene talking to regular folks in the streets. I believe we're going to be at some of the campaign events, and we're going to bring you total coverage, so you don't want to miss that. Meanwhile, the threats to riot from Obama supporters should Romney win the White House have reached a crescendo. Paul Joseph Watson cataloged some of the dozens and dozens of threats on Twitter and other social media platforms that were rolling in per hour, of people saying they're going to riot, people saying if Romney wins, we're going to go out on the streets and riot. You've got different quotes there. Me and Future going to start a riot. Romney wins, every struggling college student minds will mount up, time to riot. If President Obama is reelected, rednecks will burn crosses. If Romney wins, expletives will riot. And it goes on and on. There's all kinds of quotes, many of them not even literate, but there is a real danger here. And I heard Alex's take on this. I happen to agree with it. There may not be rioting if it's a clear-cut election, if one candidate or another clearly wins with a mandate. But we've got such an incredibly close election here, particularly in Ohio, which we're going to get to momentarily. That could be what triggers the pitting of groups against each other. That could be what triggers riots if Romney's declared a winner, but it's not clear cut, if no one is settled on the outcome in Ohio or any other key swing state. That may be what puts people over the edge. Let's certainly hope not. You shouldn't riot over that, because presidents don't even hold the real power. When President Harry Truman said the buck stops here, that was at a point in time where the continuity of government and the power of agencies behind the president was so great that it was literally a farcical and inverted statement. Folks, we're not voting for who's really in power of this country. We've got an entire corporate-controlled takeover, and we've got to begin to look at those issues bit by bit, not get into this horse race of Obama, Romney, Bush, Kerry, Gore, Bush, on and on, McCain, Obama, and everyone else we've been faced with in recent years. So with that in mind, I bring you to the latest polls on the Mitt Romney-Obama down. You've got Rasmussen from Today, Mitt Romney 49%, Obama 48%. Well within the margin of error. I know we have these stories pulled up on the tabs there. The Reuters poll shows the race is dead even in terms of the popular vote, but says Obama is, quote, crushing Mitt Romney in the Electoral College. You've got the Examiner.com showing how close the polls are in Ohio between Obama and Romney. They cite multiple new polls and analyze them. You've got Rasmussen Rasmussen's own latest poll in Ohio, what many people consider to be the key swing state in this election, and it is incredibly dead even. Romney 49%, Obama 49%. Just going off the voting from these polls, which of course only survey about 1,000 to 1,500 people at a time, you really can't call it. It is too close to call. That doesn't mean there's not other factors involved. Policy Mike is showing that in the Ohio polls, Gary Johnson, the Libertarian third party candidate, who many people don't think will get more than 1%, could be an X factor no one's talking about in Ohio. Even if he only gets 1%, that could be enough to swing it to Obama, presuming that many Libertarian supporters may come from the Republican side. I don't know if that's true because so many people are disaffected and refusing to vote for either party. But regardless, this is going to be a very tense vote. And yet we are told from NPR.org, National Public Radio, many other outlets that don't worry about the vote in Ohio. There's not going to be voting fraud. No, Romney's son is not gunning to steal the Ohio vote by rigging the machines. And of course, it came out last week and in earlier weeks how Tag Romney, Mitt Romney's oldest son, has stock in the company Solimer Capital, which is in turn invested in the Higg Fund, which is in turn invested in Hart InterCivics, who control the electronic voting machines in Ohio. And they're saying, well, there's no meaningful connection to the Romney family, but even if there were, it wouldn't matter. And so, of course, Bev Harris, again, from blackboxvoting.org, who was on the Alex Jones show today, pointed out that these various holding companies connected to owning the Hart InterCivics machines are essentially just a Bain Capital spinoff group, and there's no reason to trust them. There's especially no reason to blindly trust them. We have to investigate this regardless of what party is in power. Look back to the 1960 elections. They've been stealing and rigging elections since the dawn of time, since before they had democracy, I would have to imagine. If you accept the pun anyway. But in 1960, JFK versus Nixon, they were both admittedly stealing the vote, doing all they could to ballot stuff and getting mafia groups involved. But JFK was just stealing a little bit better. That's why he became president. And well, you see what happened to him. No, necessarily not connected to the election itself. But the point is, we can't accept these machines. We can't trust them when we know how easily they could be hacked. Bev Harris knows that better than anyone. She did the documentary on hacking democracy, the books and the materials and the website that goes with it, years and years of investigating. And yet you've got a county election official in Hamilton County, a Sally Krizzle, saying if somebody was going to do something funny, believe me, everybody would know. And she's essentially offended that they can't trust these machines. And Hart InterCivics has a long track record of supporting, quote, fair and open democratic processes. That's from a spokesman for the company, Charles Simpkins. And they're saying there's just no reason not to trust these machines. They switched to paper ballots. How dare you? How could you? Oh, really? The paper ballot systems from Hart InterCivics, the e-scan systems? Well, what happened with them, of course, originated after the very contentious 2004 election between Bush and Kerry, where the vote was hacked. It was essentially proven that in Ohio, you had various officials from Diebold, you name it, saying they were going to hand the election to Bush. He won it. That, in fact, was critical to the election. You better believe the machines played a role. So they switched, and yet they found in 2007 that these Hart InterCivics machines, in particular the e-scan and ballot now machines, while using paper ballots, could not accurately count the ballots, and therefore they failed to receive certification even where many electronic voting machines were certified. And the bottom line is, even if they were certified, anyone on the inside of the election systems could very easily manipulate it. All you need is essentially just a card you put into the machines, and it's very easy to flip it. There's no real way to account for those paper ballots, although it's certainly more reassuring on the surface. Now, that's people alleging that Republicans were going to steal it. In this case, it was the Colorado Secretary of State, Michael Kaufman, who did the testing and recertification in 2007. In 2010, it was alleged that Democrats would use the very same Hart Intercivics machines to try to steal the election for the Democrats so they could take over the House for the Obama-related people in 2010. And that also gets into the Hart e-scanning voting machines and how they violate constitutional rights, how they conceal the essential counting process from the public, how they could be easily manipulated with anyone with inside access, and how the tally software that adds up the votes from the precincts cannot be verified. Ohio Secretary of State's office admits direct reporting function of untested election software. This is in Truth Out, and they are talking about Ohio's Secretary of State, John Husted. He is, in fact, a Republican, which could be telling with all these Bain Capital connections to the machines. He has installed only days ago uncertified and untested software on up to 39 counties in the state. This will affect as many as 4 million votes in the state. It's part of a pilot project they're doing with 25 counties or so. Again, actually, it's 39 counties. So it's not statewide, but it is a pilot project they're doing during a live election in what is considered to be the critical swing state. Just absolutely incredible. Should not sit well with anyone, no, regardless of what side of the political spectrum you're on. The freepress.org has been very heavily on this issue, actually reporting on it even before Truthdig, asking why the Ohio Secretary of State, John Husted, put in this experimental software. It ties in with the Triad Computer Systems, who do the maintenance, and with the ES&S Voting Machine Company, also involved in the maintenance, and they have put in software patches, the very thing that Bev Harris warned is used to hack these machines, and that other people investigating these machines have flagged. It's presumably illegal, again, untested because it hasn't been certified, and yet it will be used to tabulate these official results, and those results will go directly to the Secretary of State's office. That's the only live reporting they do back. Again, the verification is very questionable. So a lawsuit has been filed over this issue of the experimental software by the Ohio Green Party and by freepress.org, in particular, Bob Fitrakis, who's the editor there. And so whatever happens in Ohio, the deal will not be done because there's a lawsuit in over these electronic voting machines that use paper ballots, but which are electronically scanned and counted. So no matter what, there's going to be some fallout over this. I think it's probably going to be a while before we know for sure what happened in Ohio, but we'll see what people say. And there's one more issue that Ohio Secretary of State is involved in that he implemented just 4 days before the election, and that is their new policy on the provisional ballots. Of course, in Ohio, if you request an absentee ballot, but then show up to the actual polling place to vote, you must cast a provisional ballot. And there's all kinds of fracas and controversy over under what circumstances they count. If you fill it out wrong, is it up to the ballot person to make those corrections or up to the voter? If you send it in through mail, but also file a provisional ballot, what happens? A lot of balls in the air, and there's at least 800,000 absentee ballots that have not been sent out, have not been filled in, and therefore you could have as many as 800,000 provisional ballots. Just incredible what might happen in Ohio, what could happen in other places throughout the country as well. Let's all keep an eye on this election while keeping in mind it's a two-party dictatorship, and not much is going to change regardless of who's elected, apart from the fact that I think they really like two-term presidents because of the unchecked power you could carry out. You could do all manner of ill deeds that way. So there's so much up in the air about this election. You've seen various bookies and casinos calling it for Obama. A few people have called it for Romney as well. But who has the real insight? Alex Jones filed this special report, and he's calling the shots on this election. Here it is.
Well, the results are in, ladies and gentlemen. Mitt Romney has been elected by the popular vote and by the Electoral College, the 45th president of the United States. But we hear that sound of the needle coming off the record, don't we? Because he hasn't been elected president of the great United States yet. And it would be wrong if people were saying that he was a shoo-in and couldn't be defeated. It would even be more wrong if big betting services in Ireland, England, and other areas were already paying out this weekend bets to people that had made bets saying that Barack Obama was going to win. Now, I ignored that when I saw that news yesterday, but then I began to see all these other headlines, how there was an 80%+ chance Obama was going to win in the New York Times with a Democratic Party-connected polling agency. When all of the wide-spectrum polls, we're talking about Harris, Gallup, the list goes on, show in national polls that Mitt Romney is 3 to 5 points ahead of Obama. In every single poll out there, he is beating him. In every major battleground state, Mitt Romney is tied or ahead. We're talking about Minnesota. We're talking about Ohio. We're talking about Colorado. The list goes on and on. These are traditional states that go Democratic. Now, understand something. I'm not a big fan of Mitt Romney, and I've not been out there promoting him. But whenever I see Obama using hurricane press conferences to electioneer, whenever I see the media trying to use the aftermath of Sandy that FEMA's done a terrible job on, trying to say that he's a hero, whenever I see dirty tricks like this where the betting houses, not just overseas, but even in Vegas, are saying 2-1, 3-1 for Obama, when all of the historic facts and polls show the opposite, it looks like they're getting the public ready to steal the election. It's the oldest trick in the book. When they know they're going to steal an election, they try to create a bandwagon effect where people hear that there's no way Obama can lose, so they don't go to the polls. And so when they cheat in key swing states, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, and people say, well, that's it. You know, Obama had such a lead, when he does not have a lead in any national poll for the popular vote, and when he does not have a lead in most of the Electoral College swing states, because it will be the Electoral College that decides this. We've got major university polls out, like the University of Colorado, that for the last, 4 or 5 elections has been 100% on target. They're saying 70%+ chance that not only will Mitt Romney win the national overall vote, but there's a good chance he's going to win the Electoral College. So let's be clear about this. I am seeing TV reports on the news, hearing it on the radio, reading it in the newspaper that, oh, the bookies in Vegas, the bookies in Ireland, the bookies over in England, they're all saying Obama's going to win. There's no way he can lose. In fact, here's one of the headlines here out of Business Insider. Irish betting site calls race early, pays out Obama victory, bets 2 days early. Here's another one out of the Business Insider. Nat Silver, that's that New York Times polling company. Obama's odds of winning have now hit 85%. Here's another one. Jim Cramer, Obama is going to obliterate Romney in a historic landslide. And then you look at the polls, you look at the Electoral College, everything is pointing towards a Romney landslide. But remember, in the age of electronic voting fraud, of black box voting, which is designed to be able to manipulate votes and cover the fact up, it doesn't matter who casts the ballots, it matters who counts them, as Joseph Stalin, dictator of Russia, once said. In the 2008 election, we saw $3 billion spent by the campaigns, but also by soft money. The New York Times is now estimating $6 billion is being spent this time. Now, do you think that Vegas and the other big gambling systems, do you think they might be in there trying to manipulate things? Since when do we, here in the United States, let the famously seedy betting houses and gambling houses of the world tell us who's going to win? In closing, here is why I'm so concerned about Obama. Yes, Mitt Romney's a globalist, but he will be facing re-election if he gets elected. And he will have a lot of people in the Republican Party who are pro-Second Amendment and anti-abortion and pro-national sovereignty in there to try to keep him on the straight and narrow. If Obama gets back in, the same crew that ran Fast and Furious to blame the Second Amendment, if they get back in, he's not facing re-election. He has executive orders that he's shown he'll use to circumvent Congress and the will of the people and the Constitution. And he will also have the power of the pardon, not facing re-election. All I want is to have a fair, real election in this country. And I see the mainstream, prostitute, corporate media getting everybody ready for an Obama landslide when all of the polls and the facts show the opposite. Mitt Romney has not been elected the 45th president, and Obama has not been elected as the 44th president to a second term yet. And so it's wrong for the media to be selling that hoax and that idea. Please get this video out to everyone you know. We'll be covering this right through the election and after the election. If there's any civil unrest or other crises that arise, at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com and on my syndicated radio transmission, 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern. Find stations and affiliates and free audio streams as well as the podcast again at InfoWars.com.
Now, if the government hacking elections hasn't been enough hacking for you, we can also cover Anonymous, who have announced their attacks on various websites today, November 5th, in honor of Guy Fawkes Day, that Anonymous mask that they adopted several years ago, as well as their quoted plans to storm the White House and, quote, arrest government officials the day before the presidential election. That's from reports Paul Joseph Watson did, and this story by Kurt Nemo. And so the hacker collective Anonymous claims it has released confidential consumer information that it stole from PayPal servers today, as well as from various other sites, including NBC, Lady Gaga's fan site hosted at NBC, Image Shack, Symantec, who's a computer security firm, and the Australian government. And that includes phone numbers, emails, domains, passwords, usernames, maybe even credit cards. We'll find out. A lot of nasty business going on right around this time of year. In the surveillance state news, we can turn to Baltimore, who have announced a citywide surveillance rollout that records passenger conversations on city buses. Can you believe the audacity? This is up at thedrudgereport.com. It's, of course, on InfoWars.com, and it comes from naturalnews.com, where J.D. Hayes wrote that it was published how in Baltimore, city officials are authorizing the recording of private conversations on public buses to investigate crimes, accidents, and poor customer service. It's all in the effort to make people feel safe, they say. More and more security for your safety. What did Benjamin Franklin say about this? He said if you trade your liberties for the feeling of security and safety, you're going to end up with neither. That's what's going to happen here. But of course, we know that it's all part of the larger rollout for TSA, for Homeland Security to take over all transportation, to go to shopping centers, to go to malls. They're already at some sports stadiums, to take over all of public life, to let you know you're under surveillance, you're being watched. You may be considered a terrorist if you say something out of line. And that will, of course, include public buses. It's just crazy unconstitutional. The ACLU has raised questions about it. But for the moment, it stands. Will anyone say no? We'll find out. And with more on the nanny state and how much it's taking over our society, we turn to a report Jakari Jackson filed, Eat It, America. Why are they telling you what to eat, when to eat it, and how much? Well, you'll find out in this report.
I'm Jakari Jackson with the InfoWars Nightly News. Now, it's no secret that America is overweight, but isn't it your right as an American to be as fat as you want to be, or as healthy or skinny or anything else? Well, the government doesn't think so. Let's start with Mayor Bloomberg. Washington, D.C. is ready to follow New York's example as they plan to ban large soft drinks. Not only is this completely ridiculous and very much unconstitutional, it doesn't even take an account for diet soft drinks, which can actually be worse for you because of aspartame.
You cannot go to the grocery store now and buy any type of even regular sugar gum that hasn't had aspartame added to it.
A long-term study found that those who drink just one can of diet soda a day have a 42% increased chance of leukemia, as well as other health factors. Michelle Obama is also concerned about health, particularly when it comes to the nation's youth. The First Lady launched a campaign to count the calories of the nation's school children.
Starting this year, the talented people who cook the food at your school will be offering you all kinds of healthy, delicious new choices. These healthy foods are good for your body. They'll give you energy and make you stronger.
The problem with this policy is that it is a one-size-fits-all endeavor. It doesn't take into account the needs of athletes and other students who are just generally more hungry than their classmates, as demonstrated in this video by a Kansas high school.
Tonight, we are hungry.
If we can stay in the lunchroom for one moment longer, a school in Chicago has banned home-packed lunches, denying parents and even the students themselves the right to eat whatever they seem fit. Meanwhile, several Chicago schools have earned a failing grade in the cafeteria.
Since 2011, 244 of Chicago's 681 public schools failed at least one inspection. At Cameron Elementary, inspectors found a mice-dropping infestation in the main kitchen with more than 600 scattered droppings. Here at Hirsch Metro High School, mice got into some nachos and several students actually got sick eating rodent droppings.
A hot topic today is the labeling of genetically modified foods. Some groups, like the American Academy of Pediatrics, said they have no reason to believe that organic foods are any better than GMOs, even though the AAP recognizes that organic foods have less pesticides. No on 37, a Monsanto-funded group against the labeling of GMOs, stated that new labels would cost California consumers up to $400 a year, as if food companies don't regularly change their labels for every major sporting event and blockbuster movie. Many of these food containers also contain BPA.
Canada became the first country in 2010 to ban the use of BPA in just some products. And Europe soon adopted many of these bans. However, in the U.S., the Food and Drug Administration has been much more reluctant to admit the dangers.
And if you're wondering where the USDA is in all of this, they're busy force-feeding GMOs to little Chinese children without their parents' consent. So as you can see, from the White House to Chicago Public Schools to the USDA, everybody wants to tell you what you can put into your body. Land of the free, home of the brave, but apparently not in the lunchroom. I'm Jakari Jackson for the InfoWars Nightly News.
Thank you, Jakari, for that incredible report. Definitely an issue to keep our eye on. We turn now to the quote of the day. It is from H.L. Mencken. Every election is a sort of advance auction sale of stolen goods. Definitely some words to think about. I want to remind you, you could support us at prisonplanet.tv. You can get a membership, share it with up to five people, tune into all our live broadcasts, all our archives, our special reports, you name it. It's an incredible online tool, but we're not limited to just online because we have the InfoWars magazine. It's a physical print subscription. You can also get it in the electronic format, but these paper versions are absolutely incredible. You could buy a subscription. You can donate it to people, police stations, libraries, friends you know, family members, and you get 12 great chances to wake someone up every month. And while supplies last, we'll also send you the back issues so you can get 13, maybe even more magazines with that subscription. I was in a restaurant just yesterday and saw people picking up The Secret Life of Zombies issue. They were talking about it, laughing about it, and then, of course, they opened it to read the glossy magazine, all the beautiful artwork, and many fine sponsors as well, but a lot of powerful information in here help wake people up to the zombification of TV, to the takeover in our media, and everything else covered in this magazine. Again, you can get a subscription, 12 issues plus one, 13 issues, chance after chance to wake someone up, try to reach a zombie and convert them to the InfoWar, or you can buy them in bulk at cost, save them and hand them out physically to people you know. And again, this is how we're going to wake up people inside the system who don't know what's going on, but who need to be woken up. Now we're going to be back. That's all for the news portion. But Alex is interviewing Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Schaefer on the other side about the latest information on the Benghazi situation, the death of the ambassador, the fact that they were watching it live inside the White House. We'll be back after this. The InfoWars Nightly News.